that is the midface fractures. Okay, so the midface is basically you have the central midface and the lateral midface. Now the central midface would be the tooth bearing part, that is the you have the maxilla, right, and it's where it unites with the cranium, and you got the zygoma. Okay, a zygoma is a very sturdy bone, and usually the zygoma itself doesn't get fractured, let it get fractured at the sutural part. Okay, now what is the physiology of these fractures, right? The facial structure has got lot of buttresses. Now what are these buttresses? These are the struts where you have the various forces that get transmitted. Okay, now this transmission can happen during the time of mastication or during any parafunctional load that happen. So usually what happens is that the fractures also happen along the same struts. Okay, so what are the fractures of the midface that involve the occlusion? So you got dentoalveolar fractures, subzygomatic and suprazygomatic fractures. The subzygomatic fractures include LeFort 1 and LeFort 2. We'll deal about it in just a little while. And then you got LeFort 3, which is the high level or craniofacial disjunction, right? So this René LeFort was he was a scientist, and he in 1901, that means 120 years back, he did experimental studies on cadavers where he hit the face with a bat, right? And he observed various fracture lines subsequently. So you have one fracture that passes from the piriform aperture, right, going backwards and fracturing the pterygoid plate at the upper level. You got the LeFort 2 fracture, right? And then you got the LeFort 3 fracture, which starts from the frontonasal junction, foramen, the union, fracturing the ethmoid, sphenoid, and then the zygoma, right? What you observe over here, right? It can be observed in this particular slide even better. So this is called a floating maxilla, okay? It's also called as a Guerin fracture, right? So this is the extent that you can see over here where the pterygoid gets fractured at a lower level. Then you have the pyramidal fracture, which is the LeFort 2 fracture. Now, the common thing about LeFort 1 and 2 is that they're subzygomatic fractures, right? And what you observe is usually with any LeFort fracture, there's going to be a disturbance in the occlusion, right? And LeFort 3 is the highest level of midface injury, which is called as the craniofacial disjunction. So you can see what is the extent of injury, how severely the face has got fractured. Now, one thing which I must tell you over here, that the rule of the thumb is that it usually patients don't come, patients are not cadavers, right? So the fracture can happen anywhere. It is not a typical fracture that you get to see in all patients. There can be a combination of LeFort 2 and a LeFort 3, or a LeFort 1 on one side and a LeFort 2 on the other side. So it can just be a combination. Because when he studied, it was on cadavers. But the patients who meet with accidents are not cadavers, right? So these are the clinical features of midface fractures, right? You got edema, there's facial asymmetry. And usually if you see this particular image, you'll find that the face has got elongated. Why does it get elongated? Because the maxilla tends to get pushed backwards. And when it gets pushed backwards, the molars, they come in premature contact, and that can cause elongation of the face, right? The second important point is when you observe a patient of LeFort fracture, you have to do a percussion of the teeth. When you percuss the teeth, there is a dull sound which is produced, right? Something, you know, when you go to buy some cups from a crockery shop and the salesman uses a spoon to sound those cups, and if there's a fracture in any cup or if the cup is cracked, then obviously there'll be a dull sound, right? The second thing is that the palate gets pushed backwards, causing airway embarrassment. This is the premature occlusion that I was talking about, leading to an increased facial dimension. There could be a Raccoon's eye sign, okay, which is there, because this is bilateral ecchymosis, what you see over here. Another sign which I cannot show over here is called as the battle sign. Now, this battle sign happens when there is a fracture of the middle cranial fossa. Now, this can happen either because of a LeFort 3 fracture or because of an anterior cranial fossa fracture. Another important thing which usually happens with a LeFort 3 or a LeFort 2 is that there could be fracture to the cribriform plate, and this leads to CSF rhinorrhea because the meninges have got torn. A similar thing can happen when there is fluid coming out of the ears, that is called as otorrhea, right? It cannot be, it need not be always otorrhea. It can also be something that has got to do with the fracture of the condyle leading to a hemorrhage from the ear, right? And this is the gagged occlusion which you see on the lower right side, okay? Unlike the mandible where you can palpate the lower border to find if there is any defect, right? For the maxilla, you cannot palpate over here and find if there's any stem deformity. So what you need to do is you need to run your fingers, your gloved fingers, right, on the infraorbital rim, the supraorbital rim, right, to observe if there is any stem deformity. And also you need to push your finger inside the upper vestibule to find if there is any fracture of the zygomatic buttress, right? So this is an indication that there could be a midface fracture, right? So the treatment part is you have open and closed, something similar to the the mandibular treatment. The only difference here is that just IMF will not help. Why? The IMF is not going to help alone because the mandible is a mobile jaw. When you do IMF for the mandible, it is fixed to the cranial structures, which is immobile. But if you try to fix the mandible to the maxilla, then it is difficult. The bone will never get healed. It will never get united because the mandible is a mobile jaw, right? So that will tend to keep moving and there will be always non-union. Earlier, there were reports, I mean, we used to do wiring and all, but that has totally gone away. So basically, we resort to plates and screws. It is my humble appeal to all the students that please, whenever you are asked a question, historically you can mention about suspensions and external fixation. Normally we do internal fixation and that is the best way to reduce the fractures of the midface, right? Now, these are the rose disimpaction forceps. Like when you saw that image when the maxilla goes backwards, right? You have the rose disimpaction forceps and you stand at the back of the patient. Now, one thing, this is from one of the most reputed organizations that gives us all guidelines. Unfortunately, there is something wrong with this image. You have to stand at the back of the patient when you're trying to pull the maxilla. Because what happens is that if you're standing in front, you're putting all your pressure and ultimately you will end up with a maxilla in your hand. So what you should do is you should stand at the back of the patient, right? Put the forceps in the nose and the palate and then gradually move it upwards, right? So this will be the best way to disimpact the maxilla, right? Now, what are the different methods of open reduction? So you got the vestibular approach, right? Where you can do the plating over here, right? This is the best way to do it. And you can put different plates in different regions. Now, unfortunately, I think the fracture of mandible, the fracture of midface itself is about 4 lectures each. I'm trying to do justice in 1 hour, okay? These are the different points. You can use existing lacerations, right? You can use something called as a coronal approach, that is you go through the scalp and expose the skull and do the plating at different parts, right? So these are the different spots where you can put the bone plates, frontozygomatic, zygomaticotemporal, nasofrontal, right? Then this is at the buttress region, the zygomaticomaxillary region. This is plating the infraorbital rim, okay? So one needs to be very judicious when using the incision. There are different incisions which we'll talk sometime later.